invite you to do that in the book of Genesis. What a great reminder that, look, we don't have a once upon a time hope, folks. We have a living hope. We have a hope that endures, a hope that continues all the way into eternity. And I don't know about you, but I'm thankful for that, and it excites me and just makes my heart ready to open God's Word and just expound on it this morning as we continue in our series through Genesis. We're going to be looking at chapter 5 today, and if you read ahead, which I don't suspect most people do, but if you did read ahead, you're going to see that basically we're looking at a genealogy today. Isn't that fun? Isn't that exciting? Most people would say not too exciting. But I think there are some important truths in here in the Word for us this morning as we look at Genesis 5, verses 1 through 32. And I want us to consider this theme, this idea of journeying through a graveyard this morning. Now, I know for a lot of people, graveyards aren't particularly exciting, not a place you want to spend a whole lot of time. For some people, they're scary, they're a bit terrifying. Maybe a graveyard is terrifying because it reminds us of death, that reality that awaits us. For some, maybe they're terrifying because we believe perhaps some unbiblical, untrue things about death and about the dead. Or maybe it's just, well, we've just heard too many bad things that happen in graveyards. But either way, a lot of people won't go near them, especially at night. But you know what? A graveyard might have something important to say to us. Sometimes you can learn a lot about a person by taking a look at their headstone in a graveyard. There's a cemetery in Rome where we find the grave of a young man named John Keats. Now, you don't actually know that from the gravestone because the headstone actually says just young English poet. Now, John Keats died at 25, and he didn't want his name put on the headstone, so it has no name whatsoever. But underneath young English poet, it says this: "This grave contains all that was mortal of a young English poet, who on his deathbed, in the bitterness of his heart, at the malicious power of his enemies, desired these words to be engraven on his tombstone: Here lies one whose name was writ in water." Learn a little bit about this man by looking at his tombstone. If you go to the grave of Martin Luther King Jr., you're going to find the closing line of his famous "I Have a Dream" speech: "Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, I'm free at last." You might know something about the man by reading his headstone. In England, you find another headstone that reads like this: "Here lies the body of Charles Haddon Spurgeon, waiting for the appearing of his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ." And you learn something really important about the theology of this prince of preachers, Charles Spurgeon, by reading his headstone. And when we come now to Genesis 5, we're taking a different sort of journey through a graveyard, and we're not going to find physical tombs, physical graves of these patriarchs that we see here in Genesis chapter 5. They're all dead and buried like everyone else, but they are a cemetery of sorts. And they're going to have something to say to us this morning. Here we have a list of the first generations, or the first 10 generations of mankind. And I suppose this brings up really an interesting debate that you often find when you come to this particular genealogy, maybe a couple others along the way in Genesis. And the debate goes like this: is this an open genealogy or a closed genealogy? If it's a closed genealogy, what that means is this contains in exact order, without missing anybody, the descendants all the way from Adam to Noah, a closed genealogy. So there's no gap in there whatsoever. But there are some people who believe, well, no, this is an open genealogy, which means that you have significant key figures in this list of 10 generations, but there could be several more in there. There could be many more that aren't listed. We know that that's true. In some places, in several places in Scripture, they're open genealogies. So if it's closed, we're looking at, you know, a creation account that maybe is 6,000 years ago. If it's open, you could add a few hundred or a few thousand years to that. My point is this, though, there's no need to be stubborn about which direction we go this morning. We may have our opinions, we may have ideas, but we don't need exact dates for creation to learn from this genealogy. We don't need to know whether it's closed or whether it's open in order to learn from this genealogy. You see, it still has something to say to us. It has something significant to say. And so I want us to hear it as I read here. I want to read these verses, Genesis 5, 1 through 32. And I want you to listen for some key phrases and some maybe surprising phrases as we read this genealogy. Beginning in verse 1, it says this. This is the book of the generations of Adam. When God created man, he made him in the likeness of God. Male and female, he created them, and he blessed them and named them man when they were created. When Adam had lived 130 years, he fathered a son in his own likeness after his image and named him Seth. The days of Adam after he fathered Seth were 800 years, and he had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Adam, all the days that Adam lived were 930 years, and he died. When Seth had lived 105 years, he fathered Enosh. Seth lived after he fathered Enosh 807 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Seth were 912 years, and he died. When Enosh had lived 90 years, he fathered Kenan. Enosh lived after he fathered Kenan 815 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Enosh were 905 years, and he died. When Kenan had lived 70 years, he fathered Mahalalel. Kenan lived after he fathered Mahalalel 840 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Kenan were 910 years, and he died. When Mahalalel had lived 65 years, he fathered Jared. Mahalalel lived after he fathered Jared 830 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Mahalalel were 895 years, and he died. When Jared had lived 162 years, he fathered Enoch. Jared lived after he fathered Enoch 800 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Jared were 962 years, and he died. When Enoch had lived 65 years, he fathered Methuselah. Things get interesting here. Enoch walked with God after he fathered Methuselah 300 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Enoch were 365 years. Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. When Methuselah had lived 187 years, he fathered Lamech. Methuselah lived after he fathered Lamech 782 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Methuselah were 969 years, and he died. And when Lamech had lived 182 years, he fathered a son and called his name Noah, saying, "Out of the ground that the Lord has cursed, this one shall bring us relief from our work and from the painful toil of our hands." Lamech lived after he fathered Noah 595 years and had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Lamech were 777 years, and he died. After Noah was 500 years old, Noah fathered Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Let's pray together. Father, we confess as we open your holy word this morning that it is truth without any mixture of error. And Father, we believe that your word is instructive to us, every bit of it. From the great testimonies of Jesus and his disciples in the New Testament, to the list of generations in the book of Genesis. And so we ask this morning that your Spirit would guide us, that you would teach us, and that you would apply your words to our lives so that we could walk away from your word knowing that you have spoken and you have directed us how we can live lives that are glorifying to you. So, Father, we ask this, we pray for it in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. When you look at an account like this, when you look at a genealogy like this, one of the important things that you're going to want to notice is one of the main purposes of this text is to simply push the story along. We've slowed down a little bit with creation and with what happened with Cain and Abel and then Seth, but now this genealogy is going to push the story along hundreds and hundreds of years to Noah. Because as soon as you get into the next chapter, we're going to see the story of Noah, and we're going to slow down a little bit again. And so really, the main purpose here is to push the story along. But in the process, we learn some really important and key truths that are helpful to us. So four things here I want us to see about this journey through a graveyard in Genesis 5. The first important thing you need to notice when you look at this journey through a graveyard is you're going to see a reminder of God's image in humanity. Have we seen this already? Have we talked about it maybe multiple times? Do you wonder why God in five chapters of Scripture has talked about this image multiple times? The answer is simple. It's important. It's critical for us to know who we are before we can understand where we're going in Scripture. And so we're going to see who we are over and over again. A reminder here of God's image in humanity. I don't know about you, but I'm always a little bit interested in certain characteristics that people inherit from their parents and grandparents and ancestors. And I guess it's not just me, because every time I go to the doctor, they seem very interested in that sort of thing as well. And so we inherit some things from those who have gone before us, and some of them aren't necessarily good. Every time you fill out that medical history, they want to know, what did your grandparents or parents pass down to you, or potentially pass down to you? Maybe it was a hereditary health concern. Other times, we just inherit other random things from our family. For me, if you looked at my grandparents, my grandfathers, you would say, I inherited two things very clearly from them: the color of my skin and my hairline. We always inherit fun things, right? You could tell by looking, oh, I know where you got that. I know where this particular characteristic came from. Sometimes there are abilities or skills that are passed down. You look at parents and who are artistic, and they pass that down to their children. All sorts of things get passed down. Well, here, in the first few verses of Genesis chapter 5, we see what's passed down to Adam's descendants. Let me read it for us one more time, starting halfway through verse 5. Here's what we read. When God created man, He made him in the likeness of God. That's significant. Male and female, He created them. And He blessed them and named them man when they were created. And when Adam had lived 130 years, he fathered a son in his own likeness, after his image, and named him Seth. So here are some critical things that we're reminded of in just three quick verses that we've seen before, and yet in the wisdom of God, He wants us to hear again. He wants us to consider again. Again, understanding these truths will help us know where we're going in the Scripture line. And so we see very clearly right away in verse 1 that you were created by God. Did you need to know that again? Did you need to understand that again? You're not a process of just mindless evolution. You're created by God. If you're a descendant of Adam, and you are, then you have been created by God. You've been created with purpose, created with value. And even if we should come to a day when science gets to the point where they can clone a body, maybe they could do it with animals now. I guess we've seen that, right? But if they ever got to the point where they could clone a human body, does that change what we see here in Genesis 5? Does that change the fact that God is the one who creates? Well, listen, even if science could clone a body, they haven't created life. They haven't created life. God alone is the creator and the giver of life. And here's why I say this. We'll go back to chapter 2, verse 7. where we were told right here at the beginning of creation, the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living creature. Where did the life come from? The fact that earth was formed into a human being? No. God breathed into man the breath of life. Job clearly understood this in Job 33:4, where he declared, "The Spirit of God has made me, and the breath of the Almighty gives me life." He knows where his life comes from. You were created by God, but not just created by God. Secondly, you were created in the image of God. Again, we've seen this multiple times already. It means that we resemble God in many ways, not in every way. For example, you don't have omniscience the way God does. You don't know everything that could possibly be known. Neither do I. We don't have the power that God has. The ultimate power, unlimited power, you don't have that. You don't have his omnipresence. You can't be in New Haven, Missouri and be in San Francisco, California at the same time. But God is spirit. He has that ability to be everywhere at once. We don't have every characteristic of God, but we do have morality. We do have creativity. We do have a spirit that is given to us by God. These are things that resemble him that the rest of creation doesn't have in the same way. And we're told all of this is true of Adam. And then in verse 3, he passes it down. He passes it down. This image of God that was put in him, he now passes it down to Seth. And what does Seth do? Well, he can't help himself. He passes it down to his children. He passes it down to the rest of humanity. Now, maybe you don't think much about the image of God in you. Maybe we don't dwell on that. Maybe we don't think about this image of God in us very much. Maybe we begin to even doubt that the image of God is there, that God has really played that significant of a role in your life, in the way that you were created. Maybe you just don't see it clearly. Well, listen, here's the truth. We have to have the Spirit of God to understand the things of God. And when we have the Spirit of God, things don't always come clearly right away. You see, for some of us, spiritual growth is, well, maybe for all of us, spiritual growth is kind of like an old Polaroid picture. You remember those? Yeah, young people are like, no clue. But, you know, most of us, we know what a Polaroid is like. When you take the picture and you pull it out, you don't see much. Then after a little while, you start to see kind of a silhouette, maybe. And then if you let it sit long enough, it develops more and more, and it becomes clearer and clearer over time. And my point is this, church, as we continue to pursue Jesus, as we seek to know God more through his word, how he has created us, what he has said to us, the more we pursue him, the more we seek to know him, the more that image clears up. The more that image becomes apparent in our lives. We can declare that it is true, but is it being displayed in our life? We were created in the image of God. But not only that, we're told, and again reiterated here for at least the second, third, or maybe more times in verse 2, we're told you were created either male or female. You were created either male or female. Verse 2 says, male and female, he created them. It's just two. We have a binary system here. And again, it's not that one is better than the other, or one is more significant than the other, or one is holier than the other. They're just different. Is it okay to be different? Is it okay to be male or female and to be different and understand that God has created us in a complementary way? Remember what he told Adam? It's not good for man to be alone. He created Adam to be that spiritual leader of his family. He failed miserably at times, and so will you and me. We will. But then he gave him a perfect helpmate. He wasn't found anywhere else in creation. He created woman. This God-designed helpmate. You see, we're not saying one's better than the other. We're saying they're just different. But it's a good different. It's a God-ordained different. And that's okay. To deny gender, to dislike gender, to try to change gender is to say something like, God makes mistakes. And if we're bold enough to make that statement, to declare that God makes mistakes, then let's close up this book and be done, because really God's word would have nothing else to say to us. Our God is holy. He is perfect. He is omnipotent. He does not make mistakes. He makes us exactly the way he wants us. And so when he creates male and female, you can be sure he made you exactly the way he wanted you. And he didn't make a mistake. He didn't make a mistake at all. You were created in the image of God. You were created male or female. And listen, you were created blessed by God. You were created blessed by God. Notice what it says here in the text, as soon as I find it here in verse 2. It says, male and female, he created them, and he blessed them. And he blessed them. Humanity is different from the rest of creation. We're blessed in a way that is different from the rest of creation. But how exactly are we blessed? Well, for one, we've been given a soul, unlike the rest of creation. We were given a soul, and because we're given a soul, we have the ability to communicate with God. The ability to have a relationship with God, unlike the rest of creation. You see men and women in the scripture walking with God. You see them in conversation and relationship with God. And yet, I don't know, I've read through the Bible, maybe I've missed it, but I've never seen a giraffe or an elephant have a conversation with God. At least we're not told that. Maybe it happens. You have a soul. You have the ability to communicate with God. We've been given the privilege of worship. We can know God and know how to glorify God. I don't just mean corporate worship like we're doing now, but as we go about our day, as we go about our week, living lives to the glory of God, that is an act of worship. We can worship God. We've been given the blessing of the promise of eternal life through faith in Jesus Christ. That is something that comes to us alone. We have been blessed beyond measure by God. So be reminded, like all of these in our Genesis chapter 5 graveyard, you are a unique creation of God. And our goal, hopefully our desire, is to strive to reflect that image, to be image bearers who then reflect glory back to the one who created us with purpose, value, and in his image. So we see here right away, right at the beginning of our genealogy here, we see a reminder of God's image in humanity. But that's not all that we see. You see, there's some negative stuff too. Secondly, we see a warning that sin brings death. A warning that sin brings death. This isn't new to us either, right? We've seen this already in the text of Genesis. Now, when we look at the genealogy here, you probably noticed right away, as we were reading it a moment ago, that these guys lived really long lives. Did anybody just miss that? Right? I don't think so, right? I don't think anybody missed that. We don't know exactly why they lived such long lives. There are some who would say, well, they had a pure genetic code at this point. And so the decay process of the curse hadn't taken its full effect. And so they were able to live so many more years than we are. Could be. There are some who have suspected that that water canopy that we're told poured out waters upon the earth in the flood, before the flood, in the next chapter, it kind of formed a protective barrier above the earth that kept back or blocked the sun's radiation and allowed people to live longer. Could be. I wasn't there. I don't know. But we do know that these people lived a really long time, and people after the flood didn't live quite as long. We know that these people lived such long lives, but we're told something important about them here in the text. Here's what's interesting, and you don't want to miss this. This is key here in Genesis chapter 5. Eight times in this passage, the same three-word phrase is used. Methuselah lived an incredibly long time, lived longer than anybody else in the Bible. But just like the other seven accounts, right after you're told how long Methuselah lived, you read three little words, and he died. Do you know why? Do you know why Scripture says, and he died? It's because that happens to all people. It's because they actually died. It seemed like they might live forever. When you live 969 years, when you live as long as some of these people did, but they all died. You see, there's a warning here. No matter how long you live, you will die. I hope that doesn't sound morbid. I hope that didn't teach you something you didn't know already. I hope it didn't scare you in any way. Listen, it's not God's desire that all people die. That's not how we were created, but it is God's will that death occurs. In Genesis 2:17, remember, God gave a very firm warning in the garden. He told them if they eat of the fruit of the tree that's there in the middle of the garden, the tree of the knowledge of life, or of good and evil, I should say, he said, you will surely die if you eat of that tree. And you see, death is part of the curse, and what happens now is it spreads. It spreads on down the line of humanity. We're told this in the book of Romans, chapter 5, verse 12, where Paul says, therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and we might be ready to throw stones at Adam at this point and say, man, you ruined it for everybody. Just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, listen here, so death spread to all men because all sinned. Do you want to know why death ultimately comes to you and me? We don't just get to blame it on Adam. It's because we're sinners. And the wages of sin is what? Death. No matter how long you live, you will die. But there's kind of another warning here. And maybe it's a little bit worse. The second death is worse than the first death. Did you know there are two deaths? Potentially. Potentially. And this second death is worse than the first death. For most people, I think the scariest part of life is that process of death at the end. I've walked beside too many people who lived seemingly joy-filled lives, just full of vitality and excitement for the Lord, and they've gotten to the end of life, and all of a sudden, it's like the wheels fall off. I'm like, what's going on? This process of death at the end of life, it just messes with people. Maybe it's that anxiety of never having done it before, because, I mean, you don't get to do it again, or, you know, more than once. Maybe it's because they don't know what will happen ultimately. Am I going to heaven, or am I going to hell? Will God be pleased with me, or will I stand before Jesus and he'll say, depart from me, I never knew you? That can be terrifying if we don't have that confidence. Thankfully, Scripture tells us how we can have that confidence. But it's a terrifying thing for a lot of people. But listen, worse than that first death is what's called the second death, all right? You can get through the first death, but this second death, this is bad. What are we talking about here? Listen to Revelation 21, verse 8. Let's put it this way. But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, as for murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. Judgment is real. Judgment is real. Eternal punishment is real. This is not only unpleasant, it is a just punishment for unrepentant sin. Now, the good news of the gospel is God is merciful, God is patient. God calls all people to repent and believe the gospel. And then the second death, it's irrelevant to us. It's irrelevant to us. But there is a warning here. There is a warning about death that we need to hear. No matter how long your life is, that first death is waiting. How do we respond then? How do we respond in light of the fact that death is waiting all of us? Unless Jesus comes back first, we can pray for that. That would be really good. I would be for that. Like even before the end of 2020, because this year has been a bust, right? We would all agree. And we don't want to do over either. We just want to move beyond it, right? So how do we respond to this warning that death is a reality for all people? I think it affects how we live then, how we live now. So I want us to see thirdly here, the third important thing that we're going to see here in the text is an example of walking in faithfulness. Yeah, death is a reality, but there's an example here of walking in faithfulness. All the reminders of, and he died, over and over and over, and you probably sound like a broken record as I was reading it, it makes one particular verse stick out. When you hear, and he died that much, this one verse sticks out. You see, there are only two people in all of the Bible that we read about who didn't die. You never read, and he died after their name. Now, one of them is the prophet Elijah. We'll get to that one of these days, another day. But there's another man, and his name is Enoch. And Enoch's brief account is recorded here in Genesis 5, verse 24. Look down at verse 24 again. After we're told how long he lived, the 365 years, verse 24 says, Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. Now, if you have all sorts of questions as to why God took Enoch, why did this happen to Enoch and not others, I have a really solid answer for you today. I have no idea. And you don't either. I have no idea. I don't know why he took Enoch, why Enoch was taken. The Bible never explicitly says. So on the one hand, we don't get the answer we're looking for, but on the other hand, we get some really important truths from this brief understanding, this brief account of Enoch. So two key truths here about Enoch's walk with God. The first one, significant. God is sovereign over life and death. Right? He's sovereign over life and death. So the curse is real that we saw back in Genesis chapter 3, and we see played out, it seems like, every message that we've had since then, every chapter since then, this curse is real, and it's becoming increasingly bad, it would seem. And we see that the natural course of life, unless it's cut short, Cain and Abel incident, or Lamech taking the life of a young man, the natural course of life, it's going to end in death. That's what happens. But listen, here in verse 24, we're talking about what a sovereign God does, or what a sovereign God did. Well, we're talking about the sovereign God of the universe, the one who gives life when he chooses, the one who takes life when he chooses, the one who Psalm 115:3 says, our God is in the heavens, he does all that he pleases. And when we get upset, we get frustrated that God doesn't do what we please, remember, our God is in the heavens, and he does what he pleases. So when we ask the question, why Enoch and not me? Why Enoch and not somebody else? The answer is, God does what he pleases. And he's sovereign over life and death. Listen, church, the reminder here for us is, if you're taking a breath today, it's because he has chosen. If you're still walking today, if you're still walking this earth, you're still a part of this life, it's because God has chosen that. And our response to the gift of life should be to walk with God in faithfulness, just like Enoch did. Will God then take me so I don't experience that first death? Probably not. Probably not. But our response is the same. Walk with God in faithfulness. Because it's not only that God is sovereign over life and death, but listen, also we see that God is merciful to those who walk with him. God is merciful to those who walk with him. The description here of Enoch is different than others in the genealogy. You can't help but kind of stumble over that and say, what have I just read? What's really going on here? I don't quite get it. Verse 22 says, Enoch walked with God. You don't see that very often. But you'll see it in the next chapter with Noah, those exact words. Well, we'll see it then. What does it mean that Enoch walked with God? Well, it means in some way, we're not told details, but in some way, he pleased God. We're told that he was devoted to God. He had intimacy with God. And Hebrews 11 attributes Enoch's relationship with God to a life of faith. Here's what it says. By faith, Enoch was taken up so that he should not see death, and he was not found because God had taken him. Now before he was taken, he was commended as having pleased God. And without faith, church, it is impossible to please him. Why did God take Enoch? It was a matter of faith. Here's the point. You don't know the number of days that you have. You don't know when death will ultimately come. But as John Calvin writes, there is an instruction for all the godly that they should not keep their hope confined within the boundaries of this mortal life. It's got to be beyond this life. Enoch walked with God, and by grace, God took him to be with him forever. Listen, you and I walk with God. And by doing that, we're trusting in the finished work of Christ on our behalf. And as 1 Corinthians 15 says, through our Lord Jesus Christ, we'll have victory over death as well. Maybe not the same way Enoch did. God took him. But we'll have victory. That second death, it won't have an effect on us. The sting of death will be gone. It won't have its victory. So we have an example here of walking in faithfulness. But then here's the fourth thing I don't want us to miss from this text. A word of hope for restoration. Just a quick little word at the end. A word of hope for restoration. You see, a life of faithfulness to the Lord, it would be absolutely pointless if God can't keep his promises. Amen? If God can't keep his promises, then what happened to Enoch is kind of a so what story. A big deal. Who cares really what happened here? But just like we saw hope for restoration last week in Seth's line, when they began calling on the name of the Lord, that was significant, that was powerful, that was necessary in moving the line of promise along, that promise of Genesis 3:15, seed of the woman will crush the head of the serpent. We're talking about Jesus here, right? Just like we saw that hope for restoration last week, now we see another signpost of hope here at the end of the chapter in the birth of Noah. There'll be much more to come, but look at verse 28 and 29. I want us to take a look. More to come on Noah, but just a little bit today. Verse 28 says, when Lamech, by the way, that's not the other Lamech in Cain's line, but when Lamech, there it is, when Lamech had lived 182 years, he fathered a son and called his name Noah, saying, out of the ground that the Lord had cursed, this one shall bring us relief from our work and from the painful toil of our hands. You see, Lamech has a son, and he calls his name Noah. And it's a name that sounds like is related to this word rest or comfort or relief, depending on what your particular text says. But this naming is significant because it's reflecting hope for humanity. Now, it doesn't happen immediately. It doesn't even happen fully in Noah's life, right? So Lamech's comment ultimately looks to the future, to the fulfillment of God's promise. I'm going to bring restoration, right? This seed one day, not Noah, this seed one day, Jesus, is going to crush the head of the serpent. Doesn't come for a couple thousand years here, but we see God bringing hope of restoration through Noah in two quick ways. Really quickly, God will preserve humanity. We see it. We see the hope in the way that he preserves humanity. Noah's instrumental in this, right? With the flood coming. And without Noah's family, God's judgment on humanity is going to be final, right? There weren't any other families tucked away in the corners of the world. It was just Noah's family. So without him, God's judgment is going to be final. There would be no hope. There would be no restoration. Why? Because we can't move the story along to Jesus without Noah. That's why we have the story of Noah. So we see God will preserve humanity, but then also God will preserve his promise. As I said, I want it to be clear, Noah gets us to Christ. Noah's not a superhero. Noah's a flawed man. Noah's a sinful man, but he gets us to Christ. He gets us to the author of salvation, the bringer of true restoration. And so we see hope in the life of Noah because we're desperate, church, to get to Jesus. That's where we're going. That's where this story is getting us. So today, we've journeyed through an ancient graveyard whose voices still speak to us, even though their bodies are dead. And what they do is they speak to us, they point us ultimately to a life of faith that will get us to Jesus, that will point us to Jesus, the true hope of our restoration. Now, here's the good news about Jesus. When we talk about Jesus, we don't have to go to a graveyard, amen? We don't have to go to a graveyard to talk about Jesus. He does not speak from the grave as these men do. He speaks as one who conquered the grave, who resurrected from the dead, who ascended to heaven, sits at the right hand of the Father, and rules and reigns throughout all of eternity. He conquers the grave then for all who surrender to Him in faith. This is where the story is pushing us toward. Pushing us to Jesus, the one who can conquer the grave for us. This is the hope of restoration in the passage. Noah is a glimpse of that, but he ultimately gets us to Jesus. And this relief or this rest that is hoped for in Noah, it's finally realized in Jesus. Let me give you one more quick verse. It was Jesus who said in Matthew 11, 28 and 29, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Church, Noah didn't bring that, but he pushed us along to the one who could. He pushes us along to Jesus, the giver of true rest, eternal rest, salvation. This is what Jesus does. And so my challenge to us today is find your rest. But not in men like Noah or anybody else. Find your rest in Jesus alone. Our journey through this graveyard has reminded us of several things. Listen, it reminds us that sin has consequences, right? The journey through the graveyard has reminded us of death. But listen, walking with Jesus and resting in His finished work on the cross, it brings true life. It brings eternal rest to all who place their faith and their trust in Him. And if we're supposed to take something from a genealogy like this, right here at the beginning of Genesis, it's the story isn't over. The story goes on, and it pushes us to Jesus. Death is a reality, and He died. But when you get to Jesus, oh, but He resurrected, and He gives the same promise of hope, the same promise of restoration to each one of us. If we'll take hold of it by faith and repentance, it can be ours. I hope you know that today. Amen. Let's pray. Oh, Father, Your word is so encouraging, it's so powerful, it's so true, because it's where we place our hope, we anchor ourselves to this truth. And Father, we want to anchor ourselves to the reality that we don't place our hope in kings, we don't place our hope in great men of the Bible, we place our hope in Jesus Christ alone. The only one who can restore us. The only one who can overcome this refrain of "and he died, and she died," with the hope of resurrection. And Father, I pray that if there's even one here this morning who doesn't know the hope of resurrection, that they would turn to Jesus in faith today. That they would turn from sin through repentance and trust in Jesus alone as their Savior. Father, we thank You for Your word. We pray that You would sink it deep into our hearts, that we might reflect on these things and seek to grow in our understanding of You and what You're doing in our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.